Today we will do a new topic, rumors and prophecies from the chapter Rebels and the Raj. So here they can ask you two types of questions can be formed, or they can ask you two type of questions. One is about the rumor and the prophecy, and another they will ask you that why did people believe in the rumors. So here comes the question number one, that how did the rumors and prophecies, it played an important part, okay, in the mutiny in 1857 or in the revolt of 1857. So when we talk about the rumors, okay, and you will see the prophecies, so it played an important role as far as the people to take actions, okay. As we saw, okay, first we talk about, we will take the incident, because we have to talk about some rumors. Okay, so here it is mentioned the state some rumors. So first we will take the example of the Bahadur Shah incident. Okay, Bahadur Shah's, okay, Bahadur Shah II. So here you will see that the Sipai, okay, when we talk about Bahadur Shah, we will talk about the Sipai, okay, those Sipai who arrived in Delhi. Okay, these Sipai, they arrived in where the Bahadur Shah lived, in Delhi. Okay, from, you can see, Meerut to Delhi. So you will talk about the Sipai, okay, who arrived to Delhi from Meerut. They had told Bahadur Shah about the bullets, okay, that was quoted. So they talk about what? About the bullet, okay, it was quoted with what? It was quoted with the fats of cows and pigs, okay. Then you will see that the biting those bullets, and then biting these bullets, okay, would corrupt their caste and religion. Corrupt their caste and religion. They were referring to the cartridge of the Enfield rifles, okay. So here you can see the British, they tried to explain to the Sipai that this was not the case. But now if we talk about the rumor, okay, here comes the rumor of this Greek cartist, okay, which is made up of the fat of cow and pigs, it spread like a wildfire, okay, across the Sipai lines in the North India. So now we will talk about the second rumor that was traced. Okay, you can see the Captain Wright, okay, commandant of the Rifle Instruction Depot, reported that in the third week of January 1857, a low caste Khalasi, okay, low caste, you can see Khalasi, who worked in the magazine in Damdam. So this Khalasi worked in the magazine, okay, in Damdam, okay, had asked a Brahmin Sipai for a drink of water. So this low caste Khalasi, I asked a Brahmin Sipai for a drink of water from his lota. Okay, so you will see that the Sipai, they had, he refused, saying that the lower caste touch wood, you can see, would impure the lota. So the Khalasi had reportedly retorted, "You will soon lose your caste as long as you will have to bite the cartilage, which is covered with the fat of cow and pigs." So we do not know the accuracy of this report, okay, but once, okay, this rumor, it started, no amount of assurances from the British official, it could stop the circulation, and the fear, it spread among the Sipai. Then comes, there was a rumor, then we talk about the another rumor, okay, it was what, the government hatched, they had hatched a conspiracy, okay. Here the government, they planned a conspiracy against whom? Against this sepoy, okay, to destroy their caste and religion. So what was the conspiracy here? You will see that the bone dust of cow and pig, okay, here you can see the bone dust of cow and pig, it was mixed with where? The bone dust of cow and pig, it was mixed with the wheat or the atta, okay, atta or the flour. Then you will see that was sold in the market in the town and the cantonment. So sipai and the common people, they refused to touch this atta. Okay, so there was a fear and suspicions that the British, they wanted to convert the Indian. Okay, another fear you can see that the British, they wanted to convert the Indian into Christianity. Okay. Panic spread fast. The British officer, they tried to allay their fears, but all it in vain. So this fear, okay, it agitate the men to take actions. So here you will see, again, when we talk about the prophecy, so there was the response to the call for the action, it was reinforced by the prophecy here that the British rule, it would be end on the 100th year of the Battle of Plassey. As you can see, Battle of Plassey, it was fought on the date 23 June 1857. So there was a prophecy here that the British rule, it will end. When we talk about the British rule, it will end after the 100 years of Battle of, after the 100 year of Battle of Plassey. So rumors, it were not only the things that were circulating at the time. So these reports, it came from various parts of North India that even the chapatis, okay, chapatis, it was also were being distributed. The chapati, it was distributed from village to village, okay. The chapati were being distributed from village to village. A person would come at night, okay, he give a chapati to the watchman of the village and ask him to make 5 more and distribute it to the next villages, and so on. So the meaning and the purpose of this chapati distributions was not clear, and is not clear even today also. But there is no doubt that the people could read it as a sign or the signal for an upheaval or disruption. So student, here comes another question, that why did the people, they believe in rumors? It can be asked, as you can see here, the rumors of 1857, it began to make a sense. When we talk about the rumors, okay, it start begin to make a sense when seen in the context of the policies, okay, that was pursued by the British from the late 1820. So support your answer with the evidences or the examples we are having. Then even the rumors is circulate only when they reason it with fears and suspicion. It means it is related with what? Fear and suspicions of the people. So how this statement was true in the context of the revolt? So here comes that when we talk about the rumors, okay, they circulate only when there is a, you can see that only when it relate with the deeper fears and suspicions of the people. So the rumor of 1857, here comes the rumor of 1857. It began to make sense. Okay, people start believing in the rumor. Okay, when seen in the context of the policies of the British. Okay, so people started believing in this rumor as far as when they talk about the policies of the British. Okay. So they start when they saw the policies of the British, they start believing in the rumor. So here you will see that under the leadership of Governor General, when we talk about William Bentinck, okay, Lord William Bentinck, you will see the British, they adopted policy, okay, they adopted the reform policies. So what they adopted? They adopted the reform policies as far as the society is concerned by introducing Western educations, spread the Western ideas and establishing the Western institution. To introduce the Western education idea and institution, you can see this with the cooperation of the sections of the Indian society, they set up English medium schools and colleges. Schools, colleges and universities. School, college and universities, which taught Western science. Okay, these schools, they taught about Western science, and you can see liberal arts. Then the British, they established another law, you can see, they established the law that abolished the customs like sati practice. In 1829, and you can see third, to permit the remarriage of Hindu widows. So on a variety of argument, then you can see the second, you will emphasize on the second point. First we talk about the policy, okay, then you will see that misgovernment and refusal to recognize adoption, misgovernment, or you can see doctrines of law. The British, not only they annexed the Awadh, but many other kingdoms and principalities like Jhansi and Satara. So here you will see annexations of territories as we read about Awadh, Jhansi, Satara, okay, some they put up annexed through the doctrines of Lamb, okay. And as far as Awadh is concerned, maladministration, okay. So once these territories were annexed, the British, they introduced, as they annexed the territories, now they introduced their own administrative systems, okay, their own administrative system, administration, hana, their own, they introduced the new land revenue, okay, method of land settlement, you can see land settlement. So the aggregate impact of all this on the people of North India, it was very intense. So it seemed to the people that whom they all cherished or revered or they give respect and held sacred, either their king, as they give respect to them. And when we talk about their custom, socio-religious custom, okay, whom they having a deep faith, okay, or you can see the patterns of land holding and land and revenue systems, it was being destroyed by whom? By the Britishers. Okay, it was being destroyed and replaced by a system that was very impersonal and that is alien and very very oppressive. So the perception here was aggravated by the activity of Christian missionaries also. Okay, in such a situations of uncertainty, even the rumor, it spread with remarkable swiftness, or it spread very. So here comes another topic, that is Awadh in revolt. So the questions that can be formed here, you can see we will talk about two important questions. A cherry that dropped into our mouth one day. So in the context of this statements, calibrate Dalhousie policy of annexations. So this is a statement that was given by whom? Dalhousie. And what you have to do, you have to calibrate or you have to assess it carefully. Or the another question they can ask you about Dalhousie policy of annexations is that critically examine Lord Dalhousie policy of annexation in Awadh, where you will talk about the policies of Dalhousie as well as the drawback of these policies. So, you know, in 1851, okay, you will see that Governor General Lord Dalhousie, he described the kingdom of Awadh as a cherry. So Dalhousie, he described Awadh as a cherry, okay, that will what? That will drop into our mouth one day. So after 5 years, you can see in the year 1856, the kingdom of Swan formally it was annexed by the British. So when we talk about annexations of Awadh, okay, it happened in many stages. First, the subsidiary alliance signed by the Awadh. Subsidiary alliance, it was signed by the Awadh with the Britishers. So this subsidiary alliance that had been imposed on Awadh, you can see in the year 1801. Okay, it was imposed in the year 1801 by, and what were the terms, okay, of this alliance? The Nawab had, first they talked about the Nawab had to disband the army. Okay, so here you can see, or the military force. And you can see the allow the British to position their troops within the kingdoms. So here it talk about the contingent. Okay, then you can see that with the advice of and this Awadh, okay, it act in accordance with the advice of the British resident. Then who was now, it was to be attached at the court. Then deprived of his armed forces, the Nawab, he became increasingly dependent on the, okay, they were, he was increasingly dependent on the British. Okay, and you can see to maintain law and order within the kingdom. So he could no longer claim any control over the rebellious chief and the Taluktars. So the British, they became increasingly interested in acquiring the territory of Awadh. They felt that the soil, when we talk about the soil, it was what? It was very good for producing indigo and cotton. And the region was ideally located to develop into the principal market. Then you will see for Upper India. By the early 1850, moreover, when we talk about other reason for the acquiring annexation of Awadh, you can see by the early 1850, they moreover all major areas of India. Okay, when we talk about India, you can see the major areas. It was annexed by the Britishers. As you can see, they conquered the Maratha land. है ना, दे कॉन्कर्ड द मराठा लैंड, दोआब, ओके, द कार्नेटिक, है ना, सो दे कॉन्कर्ड द मराठा, द दोआब, द कार्नेटिक, द पंजाब एंड बंगाल, द ब्रिटिशर्स, ओके. सो the takeover of Awadh in 1856 was expected to complete the process of territorial annexations, okay, that had begun with the conquest of Bengal almost a century earlier. So now comes that critically examine Lord Dalhousie policy of annexation in Awadh, in which we will describe all this point that how this annexation policy has been how this annexation took place in Awadh, and then we will see the drawback of these policies. So when we talk about Lord Dalhousie annexation, it create disaffections in all area, okay, and principalities that were annexed, but now were more so than in the kingdom of Awadh, in the heart of North India. Here you can see Nawab Wazid Ali Shah, he was dethroned and exiled to Calcutta. Here Nawab Wazid Ali Shah, okay, he was what? Exiled to Calcutta. On the plea that the region was being misgoverned. So the British government also wrongly assumed that Wazid Shah, Ali Shah, was an unpopular ruler, okay. On the contrary, he was widely loved. And when he left, so when we talk about Nawab Wazid Ali Shah, he was widely loved by the people, okay. And he left his beloved Lucknow. So there were many who followed him all the way to Kanpur, they singing the song of lament. So the widespread sense of grief and loss at the Nawab exile was recorded by many contemporary observers. One of them wrote, "The life was gone out of the body, and the body of this town had been left lifeless. So there was no street or market and house which did not wail out the cry of agony in separation of Jane Alam. Even the emotional upheaval, it was aggravated by the immediate material loss. The removal of the Nawab, it led to the dissolution of the court and its culture." You can see a whole range of people, musician, dancer, poet, artisan, cooks, retainers, administrative officials, and so on, they all lost their livelihood.